morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Hi. Today we're going to talk about prophets. We have Amos in our midst. If you've ever looked in the Bible, you've always find out that a prophet never wanted to be a prophet. It was God pushing them around, saying, I want you to do something. And usually they say, nah, I really not, thank you. Look at Job. Running away, getting swallowed by the whale, thinking he's going to get away. Gets belched out on the shore, says, I'm free at last. And he hears, Job. Nevertheless, every community that is gathered is asked in some way to be prophetic. And that is what Job wishes to teach us this morning. So let us prepare for our worship of God as we listen to the morning prayer. God of mercy and forgiveness,
we confess our sins on the whole of us.
We have harmed your good creation.
We have failed to do justice,
love kindness,
and walk humbly with you.
Turn us in a new direction.
Show us the path that leads to life.
Be our refuge and strength on the journey.
Through Jesus Christ, our Redeemer and Friend.
Amen. Beloved of God, your sins are forgiven and you are made whole. God points the way to new life in Christ, who meets us on the road. Journey now in God's abiding love to the power of his Holy Spirit.
Amen. Amen.
Thank you.
Keep our feet from evil paths. Turn our minds to your wisdom and our hearts to the grace revealed in your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and our Lord.
Amen. Reading from Amos. Hear this, you that trample on the knee and break to ruin the power of the land, saying, when will the new moon be over, so that we may celebrate again, and the Sabbath, so that we may offer wheat for sale? We will make an epith small and a shekel great, and practice descent and false behaviors, buying the poor for silver and the needy for a pair of sandals, and selling the sweeping of the wheat. The Lord has sworn by the pride of Jacob, surely I will never forget any of their deeds. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Reading from 1 Timothy. First of all, then, I urge that supplications, prayers, intercessions, and thanksgiving be made for everyone, for kings and all who are in high positions, so that we may lead a quiet and peaceful life in all godliness and dignity. This is right and is acceptable in the sight of God our Savior, who desires everyone to be saved come to the knowledge of the truth. For there is one God, there is also one mediator between God and humankind, Christ Jesus himself human, who gave himself a ransom for all. This was attested at the right time. For this I was appointed a herald and an apostle. I'm telling the truth, I am not lying. A teacher of the Gentiles in faith and truth. The word of the Lord.
Thank you.
summoned him, and he said to him, "What is this that I hear about you? Give me an accounting of your management, because you cannot be my manager any longer." Then the manager said to himself, "What will I do? Now that my master has taken the position away from me, I'm not strong enough to dig, and I'm ashamed to beg. If I have decided what to do, I'm dismissed as manager, people may welcome me into their homes." So, summoning his master's debtors one by one, he asked the first, "How much do you owe my master?" And he answered, 100 jugs of olive oil." And he said to him, "Take your bill, sit down quickly, make it 50. Then he asked another, "How much do you owe?" And he replied, 100 containers of wheat." He said to him, "Take your bill, make it 80. And his master commended the dishonest manager because he had acted shrewdly, for the children of this age are more shrewd in dealing with their own generation than are the children of the light. And I tell you, make friends of yourself by means of dishonest wealth, so that when it is gone, they may welcome you into eternal homes. Whoever is faithful in a very little is faithful also in much. Whoever is dishonest in very little is dishonest also in much. If then you have not been faithful with dishonest wealth, who will entrust you to true riches? And if you have not been faithful to what belongs to another, who will give you what is your own? No slave can serve two masters. For a slave will either hate the one or love the other, or be devoted to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and wealth." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Approximately 760 B.C., a long time ago. And at that time, the children of Israel are divided into north and south, the south being Judea, the north being Israel. And at this moment in time, the area is pretty much free of any type of invasion. Egypt to the south, Syria to the north, they're both kind of weak and stated. They're in no mood to try to start an army and start war. So at this time, both Judea and especially Israel, because of its location, is right in a trade route. And all of these people are coming in. And you might say that Israel is enjoying a really great bull market. Things are going well. And then it's that time, all of a sudden, up pops this guy named Amos. And it is said that he's not a member of any type of family that is prophetic. He's a farmer. He's what the guy who supplies the green grocer for you. And he doesn't understand him, and God says, rise up, Amos, and go and prophesy to Israel. And he can't believe, why are you picking on me? If he has any brains about him, he knows what happens to prophets. Nobody seems to like them very well because they're called to tell the truth. But he does anyway. And he does it by first observing what is happening in Israel. The old saying that the rich are getting richer and the poor are getting poorer. And he notices, how does this happen? Because it happens on the backs of the poor. So what do we read? What's happening here? He's letting us in on what the rich are talking with each other. They're kind of in a little enclave and they're saying to each other, you're the people, all right, so we're trampling on the needy, on the poor, we rule the land. And what are we saying? When this new moon is over so that we can celebrate, what's a new moon? A new moon happens approximately one time a month. And time is set aside to celebrate what's going on. And they can't wait till it's over. They can't wait until the Sabbath is over, and they say, so that we can get on with business. And these religious factors are getting in our way, and we don't like them, because our mind is on wealth. Oh, by the way, how are we going to do this? We're going to make the ephah small and the shekel great. The ephah is a measurement of grain, which means they're going to reduce the value of an ephah, so that it's not worth as much. But we're going to increase the value of the shekel, which belongs to the wealthy. The poor do not know what the shekels are. They're trying to buy grain. And it goes on and says, and we'll deceive in false balances. Ever heard the story of the butcher who puts his thumb on the scale? This is what they're doing. Buying the poor for our silver, which they don't have, but we do. And the needy, we can buy them for selling the sweepings of the wheat. How do they do that? They gather up the chaff that is thrown up on the floor after the wheat is fresh. And they take some of that and they blend it with the wheat so that its value, its structure, is less than real wheat. And so even though they're poor or buying it with a devalued money, they're also devaluing it in certain as nourishment. It's part of chaff. It has no value. And the God sees this, and the Lord has sworn by the prophet of Jacob, surely I will not forget any of their deeds. I see what they are doing. This really is a matter of justice, isn't it? What is truly just in the world? Elsewhere in Amos, you will read, and you even heard it in this morning's prayers we opened up, do justice, love mercy. Walk humbly with your God. You know that's one of my favorites. I didn't leave this church without asking to be put up as you walk in. I like the fact that I left that here. I really do, because I think it is the pinnacle concept of what we are all up to as Christians. And so, as a result, in Amos, it says over and over, treat the poor as you would treat yourself. And then goes on to quote over and over again, I am your God. I am the one that got you out of Egypt. You will recall that once you were slaves, and I took you out and I gave you freedom when you least thought that you would ever get it. And what is slavery? It is the ultimate injustice. To say that I own anybody, to say that I can take any group of people and define them into other forms of slavery. Poverty is slavery. One of the things I learned in one of my churches when we were trying to build a home for the homeless, that if doing this was a very difficult thing, because people could not really image what it meant to be poor. What does it mean for a woman with three children whose husband has left her and she is faced with $25,000 in bills? What does that do? How does it enslave her? What it does is this. These three children have not been to school in 2 years. Why? Because she's afraid to have them have their vaccinations. Because if they do, it would be seen that she has been not a fit mother and her children will be taken away from her. That is a form of slavery. Even though we may not think of it that way. So what we have to do is find a doctor who said, look, tell you what, we're going to bring you some people who are really afraid of their kids being taken away because they're not vaccinated. And he sets up a little clinic, and it's kind of under rich. And he does the work of God because he's afraid somebody will find out that he's doing something that maybe the state would frown upon. He's afraid to lose his license. This is what injustice can do. It's one of those things that goes level by level by level. You have heard, for example, what has happened on Martha's Vineyard. And before we even go into the political system of it all, some people have been taken in their poverty out of Venezuela, which is loaded with all kinds of bad politics, and have been used in some way. You can yell at what you want to say about Republicans or Democrats. These are the people who paid the price. Why? Because the United States hasn't made up its mind on what is a fair value and what immigration is all about. But why are there so many immigrants? Because some of these countries themselves are full of injustice. It is their injustice that forces everybody else to say, what are we going to do? We see suffering. How do we make it do it better? How are we going to make this sense? And there's going to be all kinds of political considerations that says, oh, I think this is right, this is right. And it's because we have not come down with a really workable way of working with immigration. But all the time, you hear the stories. Why did we come here? Because if we stayed down there, we'd starve to death. Starvation is injustice, no matter which way you put it. So let's move away from this whole idea of what's democratic, what's republican, what is humane. What is it that a prophet would want to prophesize to us as citizens or as a church? It never occurs, I think, to me, and I have to think about it. God's work in our hands is working on justice. It's not just that people should go hungry. It's not just that people don't have sanitation. Do you recall walking in here one Sunday morning and seeing a cardboard outhouse? Do you all remember that? That was a form of justice. Because behind that we said, we must do something for the health of the people who are dying of certain diseases because they have no sanitation. And we responded. What does this mean? It means that you and I, any member of this church, is now a part of the legacy of Amos, the legacy of Micah. We see injustice and we say, we can't do it all, but we can do something. And that something comes out in our outreach programs. And as a result, these outreach programs says, I can't save the world, but there are a few people at least that I can bring into the realm of justice. That somehow justice has been given to these poor, these people who are not listened to. Why? Why are there so many discovered Ukrainians buried in graves with their hands tied behind them, shot in the head? Where is justice? Where is injustice? It's terrible. So we must do all we can when we see injustice happening, because it simply isn't what God is up to. No, we're not going to be called like Amos, or Jeremiah, or Isaiah. No. But because we are a church, we are called. The very fact that you are here this morning, the very fact that you support this church, the very fact that you make prayers to God to make resolve of those things that make people suffer in the world, tells all of us at that time, what are we going to do when we walk out that door? Because out there is a world of commerce that we all belong to. We buy, we sell, there is business. And business is as unusual as we see here of what he is seeing at Prophet Amos. What do we want to do when we hear that there is dishonesty? Well, we live in a government that says, call your senator, call your house.
representative. How many of us really do that, though? It's probably very few, because at times we feel so helpless. Yet, helplessness is not the excuse that we have to offer to God, because sooner or later God simply says, you know what I want, don't you? I want you to do the same thing that I called Amos, that I called Zion, that I called Micah. They went to the forefront. I'm just asking you to do as little as you can, because I know of your limitations. That's what a church is all about. And that is what all is enjoyed about saying, look, this way. Folks put in front of them some type of goal. It exceeded the goal. And you will be reminded of what St. Paul said. There are times where I want to give up. There are times when my faith seems so small. Yet like a runner in a race, I move forward because I see the goal in front of me. And whether I reach it or not is not the reality. It's the fact that I'm running the race. And so, people of God, let us all run the race. Amen.
He is seated at the right hand.
scattered yea, grains of wheat that are gathered together into one bread. So let us gather our prayers for the church, those in need, and all of God's good creation.
Without the microphone. It has been booked. When I look at the feed after the weekend, the announcements are garbled with the microphone. So I'm going to project. Evelyn Henson has a birthday today. Joe Booker has a birthday on Wednesday. Bill Hensroth, all these people are getting so old. Bill Hensroth has a birthday on Thursday. Anybody else? Who?
Well, I want to thank you all for your concern over my recent illness. Fortunately, I felt it coming on, so I went to the ER quick. And that seems to be the answer about shingles. Get into the medications as fast as you can. So it's steroids, OxyContin for a little while until I thought I don't want to do this anymore. So I'm using a leave. I'm in the midst of pain, there's also some humor. And I have to tell you, as I told some people, I came home from the ER, and I had taken some medications, and I'm thinking about what do I do next. And so I turn on the television, and on the television there's this woman who says she's a grandmother, and she's working with her granddaughter in a garden, and she says, "I grow all my own vegetables." And then a deep voice says, "Good for you, shingles doesn't care." To which I replied to the television, "You're blankety blank right in this case." It's like anything else. I am fortunate to have, like not all people do, good insurance. Insurance I carried from my loving wife the last days of her life at $1 million worth of cost. So pray for people that don't, and that somehow we find a way other people to enjoy what so many of us have. Now let us bring forward our hymns.
pray. Gracious God, in your great gift, you richly provide for our needs. Make of these gifts a banquet of blessing, and make us ready to share with you all in need, through Jesus Christ, who sets a table for all.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty Merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ. Fulfilling the promise of resurrection, you pour out the fire of your Spirit, uniting in one body people of every nation and tongue. And so, with Mary Magdalene and Peter, all of the witnesses of the resurrection, with earth and the sea and all of their creatures, and with angels and archangels, cherubim and seraphim, we praise your holy name. We join the unending hymn.
us your grace on the road, that we may serve our neighbors with joy. For the sake of Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
And now may the Lord bless you. May the Lord keep you. The Lord's face shine upon you with grace and mercy. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you his peace.
Amen. Amen.